Hi everybody. In this class, we will cover chapter 1 of class 11 NCERT, Indian Constitution at Work. After studying this chapter, you will learn what a constitution means, functions of the constitution, what a constitution does to the society, how constitution governs the allocation of power in the society, what makes a constitution effective, what was the way in which the Constitution of India was made. So after studying this chapter, you will be able to answer all these questions. So just make sure that after this class, you write questions or you write answers to all these questions. This way, you will, you know, just get to do some answer writing practice. So don't forget to do this. Write answers to all these questions. Now, what is a constitution? It is a legal document that consists of various rules and laws according to which a state is governed. So, in a very basic language, constitution ek book hai, ek kitab hai, jiske andar sare basic rules or laws likhe gaye hain, and according to those rules and laws, the state is governed. So, this is the constitution. Now, what are the functions of a constitution? The first function of a constitution is to provide a set of basic rules that allow for minimal coordination among members of a society. So we all know that when people, they live together, they fight, they have conflicts between them. But in order to avoid those conflicts, we can have some basic rules so that a minimum level of coordination can be maintained. For example, in Big Boss show, everybody must have watched that. In Big Boss, they fight a lot, but there are some basic rules that how much ever you are angry at the other person, you cannot touch the other person. Slap is a far thing. You cannot even touch the other person. So this way, coordination at a minimum level is maintained. So the constitution, it provides a set of basic rules in order to maintain minimum level of coordination between the members of the society. The second function of a constitution is to specify who has the powers to make decisions in a society. Now the constitution has provided the basic rules. Who will tell these rules are basic or not, or any decision regarding these rules or framing of new laws? Somebody has to be given the power. So this is the function of the constitution. It gives the power to various bodies and they act as the decision-making bodies. For example, in case of India, legislature is the law-making body. It is specified in the constitution. So it is the second function of the constitution to specify who has the power to make decisions in a society. Next is the third function of a constitution is to set some limits on what a government can impose on its citizens. We said that the constitution gives powers to various bodies to take decisions for the society. But there has to be some limits on their power of making decisions. Otherwise, God knows what kind of decisions they will make. There has to be some limits. So those limits are provided by the constitution. For example, fundamental rights are listed in our constitution. Now, whenever any law is made, those fundamental rights cannot be violated. The legislature cannot violate the right to equality. No such law can be framed that violates the right to equality, fundamental right. So it is a limit on the law-making power of the legislature. Next is the fourth function of a constitution is to enable the government to fulfill the aspirations of a society and create conditions for a just society. Again, DPSPs are mentioned in our constitution. One of the DPSP says that there should be equal pay for men and women. Or in our fundamental rights, there are provisions for socially and educationally backward classes. So these are the kind of provisions that are listed in the constitution, and these provisions, they enable the government to fulfill the aspirations of the society, to create a just society, to create a progressive society. So these were the functions of the constitution, and these functions explain why most societies have a constitution. Now, what makes a constitution effective? It depends on the following factors. First is the authority of the people who enacted it. What is the meaning of authority? Authority ka matlab hota hai that aap kisi ko koi order de rahe ho and that person is following your orders. You are making rules for somebody and that person is following your rules. So authority means making rules and orders for someone and making them to follow these rules and orders. So this is the meaning of authority. Now, if the constitution makers, they have authority, then the constitution will be effective. In case of India, the constitution was made by, the constitution was enacted by the Constituent Assembly. It had the authority because it represented people from all the sections of the society. That the members of Constituent Assembly, they were preferred by almost all the sections of the society. People liked them, and that is why Indian constitution is one of the most effective constitutions. Next point, it gives everyone in society some reason to go along with its provisions. That constitution can be called effective, which constitution is liked by every single section of the society. Agar society ka koi aisa section hai jisko constitution pasand hi nahi hai apna, then that constitution cannot be called effective. Instead, that constitution will be called effective, the kind of constitution that contains provisions for every section of the society, that talks about every sections of the society, so that that section will follow the constitution and the constitution will be effective. Next, an intelligent system of checks and balances. Now, various bodies, they are given powers. Legislature have its own powers, executive has its own powers, judiciary has its own powers, and another various bodies, they are having various kind of powers. Now, you need to have someone to check over their, you know, functioning. There has to be some balance. You have to check whether they are performing their functions effectively or not. So there has to be the system of checks and balances in order to ensure that the work done by them is productive. They do not mislead someone, they do not misguide somebody. So there has to be a system of checks and balances in order to enhance the productivity, in order to enhance the productivity of various bodies that are doing, that are governing this country. So if there are such kind of system of checks and balances, that will make a constitution effective. Flexibility to adapt to changing needs and circumstances, and also at the same time preserving its core values. Now, obviously, with the changing times, some laws, they need to be amended, they need to be changed. So the constitution should be flexible enough that we can add some provisions or we can amend some provisions according to the time. But at the same time, it should not be flexible enough that you amend everything what is mentioned in it. The core values of it should be preserved. As in case of India, we talk of the basic structure of the constitution. The Indian constitution is flexible enough that you can amend various provisions, but you cannot touch the basic structure of the constitution. It has to be maintained at any cost. So these were the points relating to what makes a constitution effective. Now next is, how was the Indian constitution made? So under this various, you know, these points I have listed, just read these points and try to remember them. In fact, many points they are missing in this book, and we will cover those points in the class when we will start with Lakshmikant. So in the time being, just remember these points which are mentioned in this book. I have listed all the points and try to focus on the keywords. I have marked them with red and also I have underlined them. So just remember them, read these points. This is also relating to that. Next is objective resolution. So many times I have seen that a question is asked regarding objective resolution and a straightforward statement is there. So just try to refer page 20 of this book. It has all the main points of the objective resolution. Refer to all these points and try to remember these points. I'll just give you a basic idea about the objective resolution. It was moved by Nehru in 1946, and this resolution defined the aims of the assembly. It encapsulated the aspirations and values behind the constitution. We say that India is a sovereign country. This is based on the objective resolution. India is a republic. This is also based on the objective resolution. We talk of minorities, backward and tribal areas. We talk of safeguarding them. This is also based in the objective resolution. So all the aspirations and aims of the constitution, they are all related to the objective resolution. So again, I'm saying, just make sure you read this page 20. Next. Features of Indian Constituent Assembly. So Indian Constitution was made by the Constituent Assembly, and this Indian Constituent Assembly, it had some features. Like, first one, members of all religions were given representation. In addition, the assembly had 28 members from the scheduled caste. So all the sections of the society, all the religions, members from all the religions, they were given representation in this body. And also there were 28 members from the scheduled caste. Now you can relate with that point, that the authority of the people who framed the constitution. In case of Indian constitution, that body, the constituent assembly, it had the authority of the people because it had members from all the sections of the society, from all the religions of the society. All the sections were represented in the Indian Constituent Assembly. So it had the authority, and that is why our constitution is so effective. Next point, each member deliberated upon the constitution with the interest of the whole nation in mind. They were not being mean or selfish. They just wanted to, you know, forward the interest of their own section, their own religion. No, they had the interest of the whole nation in mind. They wanted good things for the whole nation and not just for their section or religion. Such was our Indian Constituent Assembly. The members of the assembly placed a great emphasis on reasoned arguments. They did not simply advance their own interest. So that was about the features of Indian Constituent Assembly. Now this, provisions borrowed from constituents of different countries. So this is on page 22. I have attached the image as well. But again, many points are missing. For example, Germany is missing. So many are missing. We will cover those when we start Lakshmikant book. But in the meantime, refer to all these and remember these. I'll just read one for you. The Irish Constitution, Directive Principles of State Policy. So we have borrowed these provisions from the Irish Constitution. Next, principles of liberty, equality, and fraternity. We have borrowed these from French constitution. So many of the provisions of our constitution, we have borrowed from another constitutions, and you need to remember what provisions were borrowed from what country's constitution. So remember these. So this was all about this chapter. I hope it is clear to you all. Thank you very much.